Brother Lim brought the message about you. And so we have four parts of this series. And the first part was you Friday night. This morning we're going to be talking about family, all right, and dealing with the relevancy of you, of the scripture in your life, how it relates to your family. Next Friday night, this upcoming Friday night, we'll be right back here at Thrive Life Church that meets right here in the sanctuary. And I will be bringing message three of the four-part series this Friday night at Thrive Life. And then part four of the message series will be next Sunday right here in the Parkview Sanctuary. And Brother Lim will be bringing the final message. So he bookended. He started us out, launched us real well. You missed a word, definitely, on Friday night. And I think the thing that stuck with me as I walked out of there is that I am somebody. Amen? And I need to do something. Amen? All right, that was my message. I hope that's what he was laying down, because that's what I caught, right? And then today we're going to talk about family. And, you know, I tell you, that video was a little funny, but it bothered me too. Amen? Because that's what an awful lot of my Sunday mornings look like. Amen? Amen? You try to get here and you try to look all together and you see me, and especially, you know, I tell you, I know one day God's called me to be a senior pastor. I know that's going to come down the road in God's timing. But I tell you what, if you saw me running around this morning, I'm not sure I want to do that every Sunday morning. You know, one thing Greg reminded me recently is take your time, gain wisdom, because Sunday comes every 7 days. Amen? Right? And so we're going to be talking about church this morning, family this morning. And so I don't remember if I had anything next there. Am I ready to launch? All right, yeah, we want to do this. We want part of making Thrive Life feel welcome is we want to do what Thrive Life does. We want to incorporate some of that into our service. And I just love this. Lim caught me off guard Friday night when he did this. And I thought, you know what, I like that. You know, and that really spoke to me. So I want you to encourage you to grab a Bible, grab your Bible. If your Bible is on your phone, stick that thing high in the air and be proud. It's there. You know, but remember, God's watching. So if you don't have that app on there, put that phone down and grab the real thing, right? All right? Amen? All right? And we're going to say this together. So let's say this together. This is a revelation of my God. This is a revelation of my King. This is a revelation of my destiny. And this is a revelation of the new me. Amen. All right? So as we break this thing open today, remember that. This is a revelation of your God, of your King. Your destiny is in here. Amen? The new you you've been looking for, right here. It's inside this thing. So let's break it open today. I'm going to tell you a story. Whew, I hope y'all ate breakfast. Y'all got no afternoon plans, I hope. We're going to go as long as the Holy Spirit encourages us to go. So if what you got's more important than the Holy Spirit, just go ahead and leave at the time you need to leave. I'm just messing with you. But I want to tell you, I encourage young people all the time. You like to go to movies? I don't care what's at the movie theater. The stories in the Bible are better. They're crazier. They're insane. They're scary. They're inappropriate. So I'm going to tell you one of the strangest stories in all of ancient literature today. And it's found in the book in the Old Testament, in the book of Judges. One of the strangest, most difficult stories, and we're going to deal with it this morning, because we're going to talk about relevancy, because I'm speaking to somebody this morning. I'm not sure who. The Holy Spirit told me I'm going to be speaking to somebody. It might be a dad. It might be a husband. It might be a wife, a mother. It might just be you, single you, sitting there all by yourself. But I'm here to tell you, you're relevant. You're relevant. You matter. As Brother Lim shared with us Friday night, the Bible calls you holy, a royalty. You are a king or a queen. You are a prince or a princess. You matter, amen? So we're going to talk about a narrative, the narratives in Judges. I want to give you a little bit of background. I like to give you the history, right? Because this helps us put it in perspective. All right, so the book of Judges begins with Joshua. It's dealing with Joshua because Moses has, you know the story, right, for Sunday school if you've been there. All right, you go to, Moses takes them to the outer limit of the promised land, right, and then he dies and Joshua takes them in, okay? So this starts about 1380 B.C. And then we have this period called the Judges that lead up to basically King Saul, then immediately King David, around 1050 B.C., where Israel becomes a monarchy, okay? So they go from Joshua to this period that we call Judges, and the reason we call it Judges, basically during this period of time, for about 330 years, there was no king. There was no absolute ruler on earth because the people were supposed to recognize God as their king, all right? And then he gave them judges to help them through disputes. Okay, so it's kind of like, the way to think of it historically is kind of like the 13 colonies, the Commonwealth is the common reference in modern history of what we call it. It's a Commonwealth. They have a unique unifying language, they have a unifying religion, but they're supposed to be governing themselves with mayors and governors of the city, of the nations, right? But they have these judges appointed because they need help. But they have no king because God's supposed to be king. Right, and what we need to realize is the way we get here is Joshua, as he leads us in and we begin to divide up, you have to go back to the patriarchs. There's Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There's 12 tribes in the promised land. There's 12 tribes. And the reason there's 12 tribes, those of you on the front row, why are there 12 tribes? Oh, y'all failed. Yeah, supposed to be the smart ones up front, right? The 12 tribes are the 12 sons, right, of Jacob. And so basically each son becomes a nation, becomes a tribe. And so we find the 12 tribes of Israel in the promised land during the time of the judges. But there's one problem during this 330-year period. The Israelites were a lot like you and me. They didn't like to be told what to do. Amen? Come on, get with me on this one. They did not like to be told what to do. So for 300 years, there began this cycle that you can follow all through with the nation of Israel. There's a cycle that begins, and it's disobedience first, right? So we have the law. Moses has already brought the law to us. We know what God expects, but we disobey, so there's disobedience that leads immediately to disaster, right? And then you need a deliverer. Okay, you need to be delivered from the disaster caused by the disobedience. And this is the cycle that gets repeated over and over and over again for 330 years of the history of the Israelites. Disobedience, disaster, deliverance. I'm wondering if anybody, if that strikes you as familiar. Amen. Disobedience, disaster, deliverance. Whether you're Christian or not, you don't have to be a believer. You experience this. And so what happens is we get to the final episode in the book of Judges. It's going to be the final story in the book of Judges. 330 years of disobedience, disaster, and deliverance. And I'm going to share that with you this morning. But I'm going to tell you up front, it's graphic. It's graphic. It's rough. Right? There's even going to be some parts that I'm going to let you read silently. We're not going to read out loud. Because we have kids in the room. We don't want to read that out loud. Okay? So let's start this story. Get over in the book of Judges. We're going to go over to, and I'm going to give you a kind of summary of the story as we lead into it. But we're in 19, chapter 19. So what happens is, and let me give you kind of the background, and you can kind of find your place in there. I'm not going to read it line for line, because we're just going to kind of blow through it, because we need to get through it quickly. But there's a Levite, okay, who's from a place called Ephraim, okay, and he's part of the tribe. The reason he's called Levi is because he's part of the tribe of Levi, one of the 12 sons. We don't know his name. He's referred to the whole time as a Levite. But he lived up here in this hill country of Ephraim, And he got himself a girlfriend. We don't really know what else to call it, but we're going to use another word called concubine. All right. Throughout the story, she's referred to as a concubine. And it's kind of like, that's hard. We don't have concubines today. Okay? It's a girlfriend, a servant, a wife, kind of. Just fill in the blanks. It's not a wife like you and I have today, guys. This is a concubine. This is a different situation. And ain't nobody in here going to have a concubine, especially if you got a wife. Amen? But here's the thing we need to recognize, and when I talk to folks on campus all the time about this, I get told that the Old Testament especially, God seems to be okay with a lot of bad stuff. And this story isn't about God being okay with this. When he references that this Levite has a concubine, God's not okay with that. This is a leftover from the Canaanites. They brought this behavior with them from the Canaanites. They're not supposed to be doing this. Amen? This is not how they're supposed to be behaving. God is, he's telling the story through the author of Judges, but he's not signing off on this as though it's okay. They had inherited this, again, from the Canaanites. So she was from a town called Bethlehem. Heard of that place before? Amen? All right. Bethlehem and Jesus the story of Jesus ain't the first place Bethlehem appears. This is where the concubine is from. And so this man, the Levite, goes down from the hill country of Ephraim to Judea into this little village or town of Bethlehem, and he finds this woman, this concubine, and he brings her back. And they live together for a while, and somewhere in the story, she is unfaithful to him. And then he finds out that she's unfaithful. He finds out she's unfaithful. Then she finds out that he knows. So she runs back down to Bethlehem. Okay, so she's cheated on him. He finds out, and she takes off all down back to Bethlehem and moves back in with her family. And some time goes by, and where she lived or where her dad lived was a place called Gibeah. It's in the tribe of Benjamin. Okay, again, Benjamin is one of the 12 sons. So we're coming together there. So she's now traveled down there. So the man, at some point, something happens. He gets lonely, whatever. He decides, I got to go down there and I got to get her. I got to travel from Ephraim all the way down to Gibeah and get her. And so he shows up one day at the father's house and he says, hey, I've come for my woman. I'm here for my woman. Your daughter. And the father, you know, he's not so excited about this, and it becomes this really strange. You've got to read the Bible. This is strange stuff in here. This father begins this cycle of he gets the Levite, okay, the Gibeon, the Benjamite, gets the Levite man drunk every evening. Gets him drunk as can be. And so the man gets drunk, the Levite gets drunk, and he oversleeps the next day. He's hungover, and so he can't start until later in the afternoon back on his journey because he's been drunk all night because the father-in-law has got him drunk. And then so about the time the Levite says, okay, we need to take off on our journey, the father-in-law says, hey, let's not do that. Don't do that. You're leaving too late in the afternoon. Why don't you stay till tomorrow, and you can leave again tomorrow? Okay, fine. And then what happens, evening comes around, and guess what? The Levite got a problem. He's got a problem. Because he get drunk again, right? The Benjamite gets him drunk. And we got through this cycle of the father-in-law getting him drunk every single night, the man oversleeping, the guy having a hangover, and he can't leave. And the Bible just tells us this happens and happens and happens. It's so weird, right? So finally, the Levite's had enough. And he says, let's go. It's time to go. And we can assume in the story that he gets a late start. So he loads up, and the Bible tells us specifically he's got two donkeys and a male servant. So there's the Levite, the concubine, a male servant, and two donkeys. And they head on out back up to Ephraim. Well, they leave so late in the day, they're on their journey, and the sun begins to go down, and they end up at a gate of a town called Gibeah. Okay, so they're in Gibeah. And this is where the tribe of Benjamin is. So as he's passing through Gibeon, he goes to the town square. This is, again, you got to know a little history. This is how they behaved back then. They would show up if they were a stranger in a new town. They would go to the town square, kind of generally where there was a well. They would find the well for the city, and you'd kind of hang out there. And there was a custom, right? You're supposed to, hospitality. If you saw a stranger at the well towards the evening, you needed to invite them to your house, so that they could have a place to sleep. There were no motels. There were no hotels. There was none of that kind of stuff. So you were supposed to invite them in. But the sun has gone down in the story, and they're out in the middle of this town, and nobody's inviting them in. Nobody's inviting the family in. Again, Levite, concubine, two donkeys, and a male servant. And then the night goes on. Suddenly a man shows up to the city gate as he's coming in to head to his house. And he sees these folks in the town square, and he introduces himself, and through small talk, they discover that the man is actually a Levite who lives in the town of Gibeon. At one point, he's from Ephraim. He lived in Ephraim. So they have this commonality, so he says, hey, come home with me. So now the man from Ephraim says, well, come home with me, you can spend the night with me. So they're in Gibeon, they're at the house. So now you got the Levite, the concubine, the male servant, the two donkeys, and now the guy from Gibeon who are going to the house for the night. Any questions so far? We together? And we're laying the groundwork. There's a story here. And this is where the story gets incredibly dark and incredibly weird. Okay? And I'm just warning you that up front. The author of Judges tells us that late in the evening, after they finish eating and drinking, that the house is surrounded by, well, the scripture calls them wicked men. And they begin banging on the door. And they say to the man living there, I'm going to pick up in chapter 19, verse 22. Bring out the man who came to your house so we can have... Don't say it. Mixed room. So we can have with him, all right? So we can do something we shouldn't do with him. Now, I just want to share with you, this is not so much about gratification as it is humiliation. This is common in the ancient times, actually. We have a lot of historical documents outside the Bible that talk about this stuff. The Canaanites were very, very well known for doing this. They would do this to humiliate foreigners and to humiliate enemies. It got carried over into the Greek culture at some point, and even in the first century with the Romans, we have Druid writings about what the Romans would do to them, all related to this kind of behavior, and it's all around the behavior of humiliation. So they were pounding on the door and saying, we don't like strangers, we don't like guests, nobody invited them here. We want them out of here. We want them to leave. And we're going to teach him a lesson before he leaves. And the reason we're going to do this is because when he leaves, we want him to tell everybody, don't go near Gibeon. We don't want anybody in Gibeon. We want everybody as far as humanly possible away from Gibeon. They don't like strangers there. So we move on. The owner of the house went outside and said to them, no, my friends, don't be so vile. Since this man is my guest, don't do this outrageous thing. So here we are, the man, at this point, the homeowner, they're in Gibeon. He becomes kind of a hero to stand up for the visitor. Look, just stay away. He's under my protection. Don't you dare come into my house. And then the story goes darker. Verse 24, look, here is my young daughter and his concubine. I will bring them out to you, and you can use them and do to them whatever you wish. And the men would not listen. So the man, this is the Levite, takes his concubine. The story just goes on. And listen, I'm just telling you, it's a dark story. I'm kind of hitting you heavy this morning, but you're going to see. We're going to connect this into why you're relevant. And he sent the concubine out. And listen, you can go on from that slide. We'll hit the next slide in a minute, but we just want that off. And I'm not even going to put up the next half of this verse, and I'm not even going to put up the rest of this story. But we don't need to see that stuff. It's dark, and it's tough, and it's terrible, and it's horrible. It's horrible, horrible, horrible. There's no glorification of this stuff. And the next morning we find out that Levi wakes up, opens the door, and there lays his concubine. She's dead. Okay? And we pick up the story from there. He takes her body, puts her on the donkey, and he and his male servant, the two donkeys, leave town. And eventually they make their way back to Ephraim. And he's so angry, he gets so upset with what's happened to him, that he comes up with the law of hospitality has been violated. So he comes up with a plan. He almost loses his own life. He's angry. So he writes a letter to all the major tribes, all the 12 tribes. He writes a letter to the governors, to the rulers of those tribes. And he tells them about what's happened. But as he's writing this letter, he realizes, you can't make this stuff up. They don't make movies like this. This stuff's dark. He decides, they're not going to listen to me. I'm a nobody from Ephraim. So to really get their attention, he then proceeds to break up the body into 12 pieces, and with the letter, mails a piece of her body with it. That's in the Bible. Did y'all know that's in there? And he thinks to himself, so he sends it off, and it just goes on. You want, you get a dark time in your life, you just want to sit and read something terrible, and you don't want to spend money on a movie. Read the rest of chapter 21. It gets terrible about what happens, because now the nation's inflamed. All 11 tribes are inflamed. They're all angry, and they concoct a whole plan, and they go to war. All 11 tribes go to war with the tribe of Benjamin. So much so that they begin to wipe out the entire tribe of Benjamin. They wipe it out so effectively that they realize that they have now almost wiped out the entire heritage of one of the brothers. They're killing everybody because of what has happened in this town. And so suddenly, one of the people in the 11 tribes concocts a whole other crazy idea and says, well, six Benjamites escaped into the wilderness, but they're men, and we've killed all their wives and daughters and everybody, so we need to go somewhere else and steal 600 women to give to those men. It gets crazy what's going on in this place. And I lay that all out for you because we initially need to get to Judges 21:25, as the author of Judges closes out 330 years of history of the Israelites. And I just gave you one of the dark stories of what happens in that 330 years. And then as kind of the judge or the author says, I want to close this by telling you what went wrong. And he says in chapter 21, verse 25, in those days, there was no king in Israel. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Because there was no king, because there was no final authority, because there was no one to impose the law of God on the nation, everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And you've probably heard that verse before, right? Amen? You've heard that in some other context. But here's where the author of Judges is saying, the reason I'm saying this is because of this dark 330-year history where there was no king recognized in Israel. And everybody began to do what was right in his own eyes. I'm telling you, I'm sorry, I say it up front. Maybe I should have sent out a quick cast, right, to warn you, dark Sunday morning, okay? We don't teach, I bet, look, some of y'all grew up in a Christian home where your mamas and your daddies read Christian stories, right, when you were little kids. I bet they didn't read that one, right? And I promise you, parents, we don't teach that story in Parkview's kids' ministry. We don't. We skip that one. There's several we skip. That's one of them. But to put it a different way, in those days, there was no binding moral consensus. In those days, there was no binding you guys are smart. That's why you come here, right? You guys starting to connect. Does this sound familiar? Amen? Does this sound like a society you might know? In those days, there was no binding moral consensus. There was nothing that said this is right and this is wrong. So what happens? People followed their own moral compass. Everybody did exactly what they thought was right. The strange thing about this story is I kind of briefly went through it, as I kind of highlighted, kind of skipped across kind of some of the points to kind of get through it quickly. The strange thing about this is if you go to each little incident in this entire story, you find somebody who believes what they're doing is right. They believe that the behavior that they're doing is right. As we say, we can see from the 50,000 foot view, it's horrible. But they believe what they're doing is right. When you stand back from all those right decisions, we're horrified. It's chaos. I got to tell you, as a pastor who sits in my office and some adults walk through the door, and I hear when they share with me, when they confess their behaviors, and I see when I step back from all the individual right decisions, their lives are chaos. And this is why we're talking about that. This is some of us, right here, right now. This is some of us. We don't have a binding moral consensus. We follow our own moral compasses. There's some of that in me. Amen? There's some of that in you. There's something in me that wants to say, wait. This is my life. And I'll do what I want to do. This is my life. You talk about relevant. The only thing that's relevant is me. This is my life. And I'll do what I want to do when I want to do it with whom I want to do it. Isn't that the underbelly of the American dream? Amen? I fought and died for this country. I didn't die, obviously. I'll be here. I'm resurrected. I fought and bled for this country, okay? Nobody gets to question my patriotism. But we got some problems in this American system because the underbelly of it is we want the freedom to do what we want, when we want, with whom we want. That's the American dream. I want to be so autonomous that I can do what I want, when I want, with whom I want. And I don't want anybody, especially y'all, telling me what to do. Because I know y'all. Y'all come into my office and tell me some dark stuff. And then we walk out there and you say, hey, you need to talk to your son. And I'm like, really? You're just in my office. Now, don't take that person. Nobody's been in my office in the last month. Don't go, he's just talking about me. Come on. And I don't really want to tell, here's the truth. I don't really want to tell anybody else what to do. I really don't. People think because I'm a pastor, I want to tell you what to do. I don't want to tell you what to do. I want to do what I want to do when I want to do it, with whom I want to do it, and I want you to do what you want to do with who you want to do it, when you want to do it, and we're all good. But because we're civilized, now, we are a civilized nation, amen, we add one little condition on the end. I want to do what I want, when I want to do it, with whom I want to do it, as long as it doesn't hurt somebody. Heard that before? It's probably, if I'm being honest, come out of my knuckleheaded mouth when I was 19 years old, right? As long as it doesn't hurt. If I'm not hurting anybody, leave me alone. And here's the problem. This is the essence of the story of family and why it's relevant. Why you're relevant. Now we're getting, I told you a dark story, and you're sitting there, I see your faces. You're all looking at me going, what in the world is happening this morning? What did Pastor Shane just tell us? This horrible story, I'm not going to be able to get out of my mind, right? And I certainly don't know when he said family. How did that have anything to do with family? And relevancy, what in the world, how does that word connect? Well, here we go, we're going to do that. Kind of Eminem style, we had to go through that to get here. Some of you youngsters know what that reference is, right? We had to go through that place to get, Jalen, I got you. But I want to get your mind stirred this morning. Because we live in a culture that every single day of our lives, in some form or fashion through advertising, and I love advertising. Through media, I love media. Through music, I definitely love different kinds of music. Whatever it is, every single day, our society, there's something that reaches into your heart and my heart. It reaches into your conscience. It reaches into your mind and specifically reaches to your emotions every single day and stirs that part of you that wants to do what you want, when you want, with whomever you want. Amen? And nobody can tell me not to do it as long as it doesn't hurt somebody. Let's say that together. As long as it doesn't hurt somebody. But there's a couple of problems with this thinking. First of all, that true, I can do what I want with whom I want, wherever I want, when I want, all that, it only works for one group of people. Go ahead. That only works for the super rich. Because only the super rich can afford the attorneys that come along with doing what you want, when you want, with whomever you want. Amen? And here's what I find. It's only the super rich media types, entertainment types, that are trying to get me to do this. Every day, hitting me with this. Because they're living however they want, with whomever they want. And they got the attorneys to get through that. So the first problem is, only the super rich can afford this lifestyle. You'll never hear a fifth grade elementary school teacher on Friday afternoon say, "All right, class, as you head out this weekend, remember, do what you want, with whomever you want, when you want. I'll see you Monday morning." Doesn't happen. You'll never find a DCFS worker working with some parents who have lost their children saying, "You know what, the way to get your kid back is to do what you want, when you want, with whoever you want, and the court will give you your kid back." I've never heard it. I've been in front of a judge. I'm confessing. Don't judge me. I've been in front of a judge before. He didn't say, "Shane." Well, actually, he didn't say Shane. He said, "Young man, go do what you want, when you want, with whom you want. It's all good." That didn't happen when I stood in front of the judge. I've been pulled over by a police officer. He certainly didn't say, "Drive how fast you want, where you want." Right? Because here's the thing. The people on the consequences side of the equation know this doesn't work. The people on the consequences, the people who are, their careers, their jobs are built on picking up the pieces of living this way, they know it doesn't work. Amen? And then second of all, there's a second major problem, and I'm very sensitive to this to now, because I've been married 23 years, and boy, don't get me tired. Don't mess with my wife. I'm telling you right now, I'm a protector. I'm built to be a protector. There's a second problem. This generally works out better for men than women. The truth of the matter is that style of do what you want, when you want, where you want, generally only works for men. It doesn't work for women. Because you see, in a world, and this is historically true, in a world where men do what they want, when they want, where they want, eventually, women become possessions and profit centers. They become things instead of children of God like they should be. Every single time. This is true. Where women have rights, they've had to fight for it. Where you look across this world, where women have rights, they've had to fight for them. So this doesn't work out for women. The only people who talk like this are men. So I'm going to narrow it a little bit when we talk about our family. Men, I'm talking to you this morning. You don't get to do what you want, when you want, where you want. The point, both of these two points to the real major problem. You can't do what's right in your own eyes without eventually hurting someone. Amen? That's the lie. The lie is the little tack on. I can do what I want, when I want, where I want, as long as I don't hurt someone. And the lie is in the last part of that. You can't do what's right in your own eyes without eventually hurting someone. Because we learned Friday night, and you need to go to your scripture, because you are someone. So even if there's nobody else in your life, even if you're all alone, you eventually hurt you. And you matter. You are relevant. So even if you're a family of one, you can't do what you want, when you want, where you want. Because eventually you're going to hurt you. And you don't have to live very long on this earth to understand that when you do what you want, when you want, where you want, all of us, it doesn't matter. You'll eventually be mastered by something. You will eventually be mastered. We don't like this word in today's culture. And I understand there's some historical sensitivity to this word. But you are a slave to something or someone. It isn't, will I be a slave or will I not be a slave? Paul said, I am a slave. It's who are you a slave to? Or what are you a slave to? What are you mastered by? Isn't it true that the thing, this is me, I don't know, I'll confess, I don't know if you will. Isn't it true that the thing that's mastered you has began as an expression of your unrestrained freedom? The thing that ultimately masters you is because initially you started with the mentality that I don't want to be held back by anything. And I want to behave the way I want to behave. And I want to do the one thing I want to do. And so we get these things like debt. Because we bought what we wanted when we wanted. Amen? I just heard saw a great post on Facebook. And it said, used to be, folks would trade time for money. Now we trade money to get more time. And that's called debt. What about that habit you got? You got a habit? Some of us got habits. That habit came out of a behavior of unrestrained freedom. Hey, listen, let's get a little sensitive. Some of y'all got children because of this. Hey, let me be very clear. There is no child on the face of this earth that's a mistake. You may not have known that child was coming, but God put that child here. And that's a whole other sermon, and well, you can come get me after service for that one. But I'm going to tell you right now, I firmly believe and stand on the foundation that there ain't a single child on the face of this earth that's a mistake. Amen. Then you've got addiction, right? Those habits that turn into addictions. You did what you wanted, when you wanted, with whom you wanted, and now you can't do what you want when you want. Amen? You are now restrained because society, and I taught this in a series called Boundaries, right? Society pushes us and encourages us to go as far to the edge as they can get us. And when we fall over the edge, it gets ugly. At the end of the day, society don't like the folks at the bottom of the cliff. So we get Miley Cyrus. And everybody, I bless that woman's heart, man. That's a young child of God. She grew up in the church. You need to be praying for that girl's soul every single day of your life. Because she got pushed. And she owns her own responsibility, but she got pushed to the edge. And then she became a joke. Not because I say she's a joke. Society is calling her a joke. But they pushed her there. You have a master. Who's your master going to be? Choose this day whom you're going to serve. Not choose this day, will you serve someone? Choose this day whom you're going to serve. Because you have a master. But here's the other part. It's not just you that you hurt. You hurt the people with you. Amen? This is family. This is where relevancy to family matters. You don't just hurt you. You hurt the people with you. I love sharing with my son. I got a 14-year-old boy, and Proverbs has a beautiful verse for this. It says that the companion of fools suffers much harm. Use that one with your kids. The companion of fools. You don't have to be a fool. You just got to be near a fool. Amen? You be with a fool, and you're going to get some harm coming your way. This is why I freak out about my kids' friends. My son tells me all the time when he's around these knuckleheads, and I know them all, I know their parents. He forgets. I know everything about these people. They tell me. I don't want to know. I'm a pastor. You ever want to know everything about somebody? Put the title pastor before your name. They just come up and they just start, I call it verbal vomiting. Sorry if that's inappropriate, but they come up to me and I'm going to go with these people. And I'm like, you need to really think about that, son. But I'm not going to do what they're going to do, but you're going to be near what they're doing. And when you're near what they're doing, that's going to rub off on you. You hurt the people who care about you. You don't just hurt you. You don't just hurt the people around you. You hurt the people who care about you. And every single one of you in this room right now, you may not realize it, but there's somebody out there that cares about you. At the very maximum, Jesus Christ himself cares about you. So I know that's true about every one of you. But I'd be willing to bet if I knew anything about you, I can name one or two or three or 100 people that care about you. And they're praying for you. And they're worried about you. Because you hurt the people who care about you when you do what you want, when you want, where you want, how you want. And then finally, you hurt the people coming after you. Amen? I've become very conscious of this as a father. I got two boys. I love them to death. I was sharing with a couple folks this morning. I'm just having the time of my life being a daddy. I got a 14-year-old and a 12-year-old, and they just get me. And I get them, I guess you could say. And I'm just having the time of my life. Now, I'm not their best friend, but I'm having the time of a life as a daddy. But can I be personal with you for just a moment? Can we get a little difficult? Some of y'all are weird. Amen? Some of y'all are dysfunctional. Aren't you? Come on. Some of y'all are kind of odd. Okay? There's a reason you don't get invited to some parties. You got some things that you do, and we talked about this in the last sermon. You got some things you do, you don't know why you do them. Right? Paul said, the things that I do, I want to do, I do not do, and the things that I know I should not do, I do. And I don't understand why. And can we just confess, some of y'all are just hard to get along with. Some of y'all are just difficult. And it's a problem in your life. And if you're over 20 years old, you've thought about this. And you've probably figured it out. Some of you understand the reason. I know this is true for me. That you're a little weird. The reason you're a little off is your parents. Amen? Go ahead, be bold. I don't care if your parents sit next to you. Say it, Jalen. Amen. He's not 20 yet. He don't know that, but I'll tell him now. It's because of who's sitting next to you, buddy. I know my son, Joshua and Caleb. I know they're strange, and it's all because of me. And they got a mama that constantly goes, Shane, seriously, stop. What are you doing? And I always tell them, my go-back line is, just tell them to talk to their therapist when they're 30. Just tell them to go talk to their therapist. Amen? Because some of y'all are off because your mom and daddy. We know we hurt the people coming after us because it happened to us. You know what? Your mom and daddy said this. They said, I'm going to do what I'm going to do, when I want to do it, where I want to do it. And they forgot to think about you. They didn't think they were relevant to your life. They were caught up in what they were doing. And they would have said, if we'd have asked them at the time, the same thing a lot of us say. It's not hurting anybody. But isn't it true it's hurting you every day of your life? It hurts somebody. You are relevant. You do matter. You are somebody. You have a family. Even if you're single, you have a family. We call this thing called church family. We're going to talk about church next week, or Friday, right? But your family, those people around you, whatever you want to call them, those people, you know, there's all these things going on Facebook about, you know, family isn't just about blood. I agree. I got friends that are closer than family. And I call them family. They're my brothers. And the fact of the matter is, you matter. That you are relevant to people around you. And this is such a selfish standard that we've set in our society. We can do what we want, when we want, where we want, right? And I think it's on the church. It's on the Christians to flip that and say enough. And not to go out there preaching it, to go out there and start living it. Amen? Why can't we have this standard coming out of the church? I should be able to do what I want, when I want, with whom I want, as long as it helps somebody. Amen? Can we flip that up a little bit? Can our standard be, I'm willing to do anything but sin to help somebody? And at the end of the day, let's just admit it, the reason we struggle with this is because we're all hypocrites. Come on. Amen. Got to have the amen there. We're all hypocrites. Remember that cycle? Remember that cycle? Disobedience, disaster. The next phase is the hypocrite phase. Because when disaster strikes, what do? Pray. When disaster strikes, what do? Call mama. Call daddy. I don't know about y'all, but I made that phone call. I was that knuckleheaded kid. I went out the door with a group of friends, and my dad said, you shouldn't go with them, son. They're trouble. Man, you don't understand. My dad was an idiot. Don't amen right there. Let me keep you out of trouble. My daddy was an idiot. Yeah, he's going to tell me what to do and what not to do. About 2 hours later, ding. Daddy, I'm at the police station. No, sir, it wasn't a school field trip. I need you to come get me. You know what my daddy said? See you tomorrow. He did. He let me sit overnight. So if you got a daddy come get you that day, God bless you. But my daddy came the next day and got me out of there. Why? Because we're all hypocrites. We do what we know we shouldn't do, but we want to do it. We do it when we want to do it. But when we get in trouble, and the trouble always comes, we pick up the phone or we dial the Holy Spirit through some prayer, right? So I want to wrap it up. I want to say, listen. I have good news on this. You are relevant. Don't ever think you're alone. Don't ever think you don't matter. Just as there are no babies that are mistakes, there's no adults that made it into adulthood, that you're not here by accident. You have people that need you, count on you, and that you're relevant to. And here's the good news. As a Christian, this is what I believe. As a Christ follower, I believe that Jesus has invited us to call our heavenly God Father. Amen? He's invited us to call Him Father. And that ultimately, any good thing coming from my heavenly Father, including any rule, any insight into the way I should behave or not behave, any insight into how I can have a better relationship with my wife, anything that comes from my heavenly Father is good. And it matters. Because He's told me I matter. If I didn't matter, I don't need to follow the Bible. And the strange thing is, when we do what's right in our own eyes, this is the promise of the Bible, and this is the testimony of my life. When we do what's right in our own eyes, and we just diss God, and the world falls apart, and we all pray. One of the interesting things we find about the Old Testament is that every time the nation of Israel disobeyed, disaster followed, and when they sought God's face, guess what? He showed up. That's an amen, y'all. Every single time, He showed up. They said, we need help, Lord. The God who had been ignored, the father who had been embarrassed by his kids, the father whose rules had been disobeyed, the father who had been abandoned to other fathers, to other idols. That very same God stepped in every single time and rescued them. Rescued them. That's what he did for me. The good news is that as I talk about this today, and Pastor Lim, and I'm going to talk Friday night, and then Pastor Lim's going to talk next Sunday, and we go through this series called Relevant, the great news is that God the Father chose to step into the chaos of our disobedience. He stepped into the chaos of our rebellion and sent you. He sent me a deliverer. And he invites you to call on him today. You are relevant. You matter. God loves you so much that can you connect with this? He loves you so much, he doesn't want you to just do what you want, when you want, where you want to do it, with whomever you want to do it. He loves you that much, like any good father was. He wants to help guide you because he has a plan for you. And his plan is pure, and his plan is good. And he's got a plan for you in your family. You're not an accident in your family. You're not supposed to be there. I see this all the time. Guys come up to me. They go, I'm not sure if I'm in love with my wife. I said, did you say I do? Yes. Get back on the horse, buddy. Let's go. Figure it out. You can't do what you want, when you want, with whom you want, and it work out for you. Now, the good news is God will be there to pick up the pieces, but I would encourage you not to cause so many accidents on the road of life. Maybe minimize some of the accidents. You can minimize them by reading this thing, okay? And you can minimize them by calling on God. We're going to close up. Mario, you can bring your team on up. We're going to do that thing we do called invitation. And here's what I'm inviting you to do this morning. If you're not a Christ follower, you wonder who this Jesus is I'm talking about, come up here and ask me about him. I'll tell you all about it. Because I met him. You think, that man died 2,000 years ago. No, he resurrected. I met him. But I also want to encourage you, if you're on that road of life and there's some accidents been smacking you in the head, you've been disobeying, and you've got some disasters, come on up. Pray with us. Come on up to the altar. There's this thing up here that we recognize called an altar, where you kneel and lay that down at the foot of the cross. At the foot of the cross. We got this pretty little cross up here, all right? Come forward and lay it down. Decide today, I'm done with it. I need help. Deliver me, God. I can't do it by myself. And come into my life and get this out of me. Fix this. Your Heavenly Father will answer. He will come to you. He will deliver you. Amen. Let's sing this together. I believe we stand up. We're going to stand up.